Hello, once again, a very good afternoon to all. Okay, probably in the last class, I hope we have covered about the concepts of this wired communication, wireless communication, basic definitions that we have seen, and then what are the different types of wireless communications that are available, and out of all, which one we are trying to look at it, especially the cellular mobile communications. Which is what the basic topic that we would be considering. And then I hope you have looked at different generations of the cellular systems. Okay, that's what I hope you have covered it in the last class, which was basically an introduction part. Now, in today's class, what we will do is, okay, we will try to cover the basic concepts, cellular concepts, and we will try to define what do you mean by cell, and then the base station, why do we require a base station and all. So let me go through the contents. Okay, so we will try to go step by step. We'll try to understand first what do you mean by this half duplex communication and full duplex communication, and then when you have a multiple number of users present, which is what the basic case, then how the communication is going to take place. And what is the basic problem with that multi-user communication? And we'll try to see if the problem can be overcome using the concept of base station. And then we'll try to see what do we mean by, or how do we place a particular base station. Okay. And then we'll try to look at the concepts of taking up a single cell and putting up a base station and doing that analysis. And then we'll try to extend that particular discussion to multiple cell system. And then at the same time, what should be the cell shape that one has to consider? Okay, the discussion on that also we'll try to have. And then probably at the end, we'll try to look at the concept of frequency reuse. Okay, so before starting up, I would like to take up or I would like to review the topic that I have done it in the last class, which is radio spectrum. I hope we have done it in the context of basically in the second generation mobiles. What is the spectrum that is being allocated? Okay, that is, we said that there is 25 megahertz bandwidth, 25 megahertz bandwidth that is allocated for uplink, and 25 megahertz that is allocated for downlink. And uplink and downlink both are different so that we can avoid the interference. You know, we'll see that particular thing, okay, in a little while. But this concept is quite useful in understanding further concepts. So I'm just repeating it again. So the basic frequency band that is being used in 2G is like 890 megahertz to 915 megahertz, and then 935 to 960 megahertz. And then what we said it is this complete bandwidth of 25 megahertz is being divided into each of 200 kilohertz. That means this complete 25 megahertz is being divided into 200 kilohertz, 200 kilohertz, 200 kilohertz, and so on. That means if I'm trying to look at this particular portion, okay, the bandwidth of this particular, this each individual, I can call that as a channel. Now, this particular channel has a bandwidth of 200 kilohertz. In general, okay, when I wanted to make a voice call, we know that, okay, for a particular voice call, the bandwidth that is required is, okay, you know that, okay, the voice signals will occupy a bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. So, at least, okay, multiplied by two, then around 10 kilohertz is sufficient to transmit a voice call. But the amount of bandwidth that is available here is around 200 kilohertz. So it is sufficient to transmit a voice call. Hence, that voice was the primary thing in your second generation mobiles. On top of that, we had some data services. The 200 kilohertz, whatever that we are trying to say, is, okay, voice plus data. That is the reason why, okay, we are trying to allocate, okay, 200 kilohertz amount of data. Okay, so that is what that we have already discussed. Okay, like in the same way, whatever that we had in uplink, you have same thing in downlink. Like each one has a bandwidth of 200 kilohertz, and we said that, okay, this is a 200 kilohertz band. And then what calculations that we made is overall 25 megahertz bandwidth is available. Now if I'm dividing it into each as 200 kilohertz, the number of total number of channels that is available is 125 number of channels. That means I have this 125 number of channels here. Okay, So that means, suppose in a particular system, if a cell, if I have 125 members of users, what I can do is I can allocate each one to one user, and then he can start communicating it. That's the basic idea of it. And further, okay, I've included this particular concept for this particular slide. Just try to understand. So if this is the okay channel that I'm trying to consider, let me name this channel as F1. Okay. So the bandwidth of this is 914.8 to 915. That means starting point here is 914.8, and then this is ending point is 915. So total a bandwidth of 200 kilohertz that is available. So the center frequency of that I'm trying to consider it to be 914.9. So I've considered the center frequency to be 914.9. I hope you might have seen in your analog communication, digital communication, you are trying to put your message on top of your carrier. Same thing I'm trying to do it here. Suppose a person wants to send his message. Let's assume that this is the spectrum of the message signal. Now he's trying to keep on this carrier, and this carrier is being transmitted through the channel. Hence we call this basically F1 as a channel. Try to understand the concept of this channel, because this is what we are going to use it in further slides. So what we are trying to do is the total bandwidth that is available is 200 kilohertz, but our service requirement would be less than this. If it is a voice call, then the bandwidth required would be quite low. So hence on this particular carrier, I'm trying to put my message, and this I'm trying to transmit. Okay, so this is the basic idea, and this is what I call it as channel. So if this is first channel, then this I can take it as second channel. So total number of channels that are available with me is 125 number of channels. That means at a time only 125 number of users can communicate. Okay, all that you have to do is we have to utilize the spectrum very efficiently so that we can cover more number of users. That's the basic challenge that we had. Okay, and with this particular concept, we'll try to get into our basic concepts of cellular communications. Okay, but understanding this concept is quite very clear, because F1, in the sense, the moment when I'm trying to repeat F1, probably it could be a single channel with a bandwidth of so and so. This is specifically in case of GSM, but this could be different for different generations. Okay, in fact, you can define your own spectrum and then probably the bandwidths and all. Okay, but for example sake, let me take that GSM and then let us try to analyze the things. Okay, and then we said, we'll try to understand the two major things. One is half duplex communication and then a full duplex communication. Half duplex communication is basically, it is a two-way communication. Okay, but now you try to understand the number of channels that is available is only one channel that is available. Channel in the sense, just now whatever we talked, F1. That means I have only a bandwidth of around 200 kilohertz, and one channel is available. Okay, so what we do is, say in this transmitter, and these are, I'm putting it as transceivers. That means it can transmit as well as receive both. Okay, now what I'm trying to do it here is, you can see that as I have only one channel available, only one person can talk at a time. That means if he is sending his information, the other person cannot transmit his information, because I have only one channel. That one channel, whatever that we have considered is that F1. So I have only one channel that is available. So either I can transmit, or basically I can transmit. That means while I am transmitting, other person cannot transmit because I have only one channel. If I wanted to put both, if both the persons want to transmit, then obviously you'll have that interference, because the center frequency of that would be same. So you are putting same information, hence you will have that interference. Okay, so that is a basic disadvantage of this half duplex communication. Or the specifications for this half duplex communication is, it is two-way communication, but a single channel available. Because of that single channel, either only one at a time, only one can talk. Okay, so that is the basic problem that we had. That, and you can see that when he is trying to transmit, the other person, then he cannot transmit. Okay, So this is basically a half duplex communication. So in the sense half duplex communication, you have only one channel available. This is the only channel that is available. Hence, okay, we will be able to either transmit or receive. That is in case of half duplex communication. The next one is full duplex communication. Okay, in case of full duplex communication, again it is a two-way communication. But now the advantage that I have is here I have two channels. Okay, so I have two channels. So what I can do is transmitter can transmit on one particular channel and receive on another channel. So it is kind of a live communication that is taking place between two persons. Okay, so I am considering transceiver and the other transceiver I'm trying to consider. You can see that I'm trying to take, as I have two channels that is available, both the things are on. That means simultaneously one can transmit as well as receive, because he can transmit with a channel F1 and the other can transmit with a channel F2. So you can see that, and this F1 and F2 are different channels, because we have seen just now in case of radio spectrum, for uplink you have some set of frequencies and downlink you have other set of channels that are available. So hence these are two different channels and they would not be interfering. Hence what is possible is this two-way communication or a live communication that is possible. Okay, this is basic definition for your full duplex communication. Okay, and having said about, now see, the understand these concepts of F1, F2 and all. Okay, these are basically a channel, that is the channel that is available. Now instead of these two users, suppose if I have a multiple number of users, okay, then what is the problem that we will be facing it? Okay, so to understand that, I'll be considering three users. Okay, let's consider three users, probably yellow, red and purple. Suppose if this person wants to talk with red, this yellow wants to talk with red, then he is trying to communicate with this with a channel F1 and he is trying to receive that information with F2. Okay, this is the full duplex communication that we have between these two. And suppose if this wants to communicate with this particular person, the purple, then that also can be done, because he will be transmit, because basically the transmission frequency for him is F1 and the reception is F2 with respect to this when I am talking. Now in this particular scenario, suppose if this red and purple wants to communicate, then you can see that what is the transmission frequency with which the red is transmitting? He has to transmit with F2. And what is the transmission frequency of purple? He is also transmitting with a channel F2. In that case, you can see that both of them are transmitting and receiving with the same frequency. So hence you will get the interference. So that is a basic problem when I am trying to extend it for multiple number of users. To avoid this, what you can do is you can assign different set of frequencies. That is one solution that we have. That means you can go for F3 and F4. But now the problem here is, you can see that this person red, okay, need to have two frequencies, F2 as well as F3. That means if the number of persons are keep on increasing in the scenario, then the amount of channels that we have to make available would also be increasing. That in turn leads to what? The more amount of spectrum, the requirement of more amount of spectrum, which is what very costliest thing. As we said, there is a reason why we said the biggest challenge that we have, it is utilization of this spectrum very efficiently. Okay, so that is the basic problem that we have. So that's what I have written it here. You have this interference between these two. So hence you have to allocate two different frequencies here. Okay, so the basic disadvantage that you'll be having, it is as the number of frequencies are getting increased, okay, the spectrum requirement would also be increasing, and that would be a major problem. To avoid that, what we are trying to do is we are trying to introduce the concept of base station. Okay, let's look at the concept of base station and how this particular base station is going to solve the problem. Okay, For that, let me make use of, again, in a three user scenario I'm trying to consider. But this time what we are trying to do is, we are trying to put up a base station in between. Okay, now these people or these three will not be communicating, okay, directly. Rather, what they do is they will try to communicate through this particular base station. Okay, so when this particular person wants to communicate, then he will be communicating with base station with a frequency F1, and he'll be receiving with a frequency F2. And suppose if he wants to communicate with this base station F5 and F6, and if he wants to communicate F3 and F4. Now, suppose if this person wants, hello, wants to, okay, talk with this purple, all that he has to do is he'll be transmitting with a frequency F1 to the base station. And basic job of this base station is what? It will take this information on the carrier frequency F1 and it will translate it to the frequency F3. Okay, so that means the basic job of this base station is, it is trying to translate this particular frequency to another frequency, whichever is the intended for this particular mobile. Okay, so basically it acts as frequency translator. So he can, now when these two are getting, okay, communicating, like F1 is being translated to F3. So this mobile handset are communicating through this particular base station, okay, indirectly. That's what the basic concept. Now you can see that, now suppose if this person wants to communicate with this, okay, even then also he'll be transmitting his information with F1, because what base station does is, whatever the information that we have on that F1 carrier, that will be translated to frequency F5. So you need not go for different frequencies here, okay, for each and every, okay, mobile we can have this fixed set of frequencies that can be allocated, and accordingly a communication can take place. So with this particular, okay, base station, you can solve the problem or problem of the multi-user scenario, or in fact you can have more number of users. You can have n number of users in this particular scenario, but still, okay, he'll be communicating with these things, okay, and the frequency translator will do the job for us. Okay, that is the reason why we do consider this particular base station. Okay, so that is the concept of a base station. And then, okay, so as we said, mobile stations will communicate indirectly with this frequency translator. Okay, and then let's look at the terminology, some terminology that we were using, it like uplink, downlink, or mobile, like in the radio spectrum we have used this mobile to base station and base station to mobile. Okay, let's get familiar with this. When I have this mobile station and then this is base station, okay, now when I'm trying to transmit from mobile station to base station, we call this as basically uplink. This is uplink with respect to mobile. When I'm talking this with respect to mobile, you can see that it is trying to uplink to the base station. But the same thing with respect to base station, when I'm talking, we call it as reverse channel. With respect to base station, we call it as reverse channel. With respect to mobile, we call it as uplink. This is the general terminology that we'll be using it every now and then. Okay, so try to get acquainted with this terminology. Okay, example is like GSM. In GSM, we have seen 890 to 915 megahertz. We have written there like mobile station to base station. Okay, this is the basic terminology that you have, uplink. Either you can call this as uplink or reverse channel. In other words, this we call it as, with respect to mobile, we call it as downlink, or with respect to base station, now you can see that it is a forward channel. And the example of that could be what, as we have seen in case of GSM, it is from 935 to 960 megahertz, 25 megahertz bandwidth, that and that is what is being shown. So this is the terminology that we will be using very often. So try to be careful and try to understand these things. Okay, uplink and downlink. And as we said, uplink and downlink frequencies are different. You can see that this is different band and this is different band, so that there will not be any interference. That's what we have seen in case of your full duplex communication. Okay, so this is the basic terminology with respect to your mobile as well as base station. Okay, Now, let us consider a single cell system. As we said, what we are trying to consider is we are trying to consider the entire geographical area of that particular Earth. Okay, and we are trying to put up one base station. I'm assuming that this complete thing is a cell, wherein I'm trying to put one base station over here. That's the reason why we are just calling it a single cell system. So we'll try to see what is the problem, okay, and what is the consequences of these. We'll try to understand it. Okay, now you can see that, as we said, this complete geographical area I'm trying to put up a base station. Now you can see that as I'm trying to deploy this particular base station, I have only one base station and it has to cover all the number of users. Okay, that is very huge task. Okay, and then the second, okay, the term is the transmission power. Okay, because we know that as the distance increases, the received power would be decreasing. So the amount of transmission power with which he has to transmit would also be increasing, because as the distance is very large, almost, okay, very large. Okay, and again, to cover almost all these things, the height of the antenna, I should also keep it very large, because generally these antennas would be communicating on a line of sight. So we should have a large base station with large antenna height, with a huge transmission power. And obviously you have more number of users. As the more number of users we have, to cover all those things, we need to provide huge amount of bandwidth. Okay, that is the requirements for your single cell system. If I'm trying to look at, even in that case also, if I'm trying to look at it, you can see that what is the maximum area that can be covered by this particular base station. This is the line of sight path that you have, and this is the line of sight path that you have on this particular side. Okay, you can see that even in any of this particular case, it cannot transmit to this particular area. So you cannot, the single base station is not sufficient to cover entire thing. So probably you may have to put another base station here and another base station. So more number of base station that we need to put up. Okay, so, but the basic disadvantages with this a single cell system is, or a single base station system is, basically the first thing is you need to transmit it with very high power. Okay, and then you need to transmit it with very high band, you need to have very high bandwidth, and then the large antenna size that you have to use. As I said, large base station, hence high bandwidth. Just, okay, try to be careful with this bandwidth term. Why do we require high bandwidth? Because we have seen, if a person wants to communicate, you need to allocate a channel. Okay, now if all of them simultaneously want to talk, then you should have more number of channels. More number of channels means more amount of bandwidth. Okay, as you can see that the more number of users present on this particular part of Earth, okay, so more huge amount of bandwidth that I have to make it available. So that is the disadvantage that we have with respect to these things. So it requires high transmission power, high bandwidth, and high antenna height. Almost, okay, impractical kind of thing as far as this particular cellular communications is concerned. Anyhow, this is, okay, possible with respect to your satellite communication, but we are trying to, okay, deal with this cellular communications. So single base station is not sufficient to cover the entire area, geographical area that I'm trying to consider. Okay, so this setup basically we'll try to represent in this way. So this is the geographical area that I wanted to cover, and I'm trying to deploy a base station inside that. This is what you call it, a single cell system. So this representation, we are trying to put it in this way, because from here on we'll try to take up this particular, okay, pictures, and this way we'll try to explain the concept. Anyhow, we'll try to come back to this concept of this hexagonal cell shape, or for that matter, even you can take up this circular shape also, you can take and you can go forward. But as of now, let us try to understand that, okay, this kind of, okay, system we'll try to put up in this way, a single cell system where you have a base station. Okay, so keeping this in the mind, we will, okay, try to look at the concepts now. Okay, now let us try to understand concept of circular footprint. So now I am trying to any particular area I would like to deploy a base station. Obviously, when I'm trying to deploy a particular base station, this antenna, whatever that I'm trying to have, should be omnidirectional antenna. That means it should be radiating in all the directions equally, almost equally in all the directions. So this is what I'm trying to say, that it is trying to radiate equally in all the directions. So what is the area covered by this particular antenna? Because when I'm trying to radiate, as the medium is free space, I'm trying to transmit with something. As the distance increases, the power received would be decreasing. That is the basic idea, that we have. So you can see that this is the area that is what is being covered by this particular base station. In general, you call this as basically the footprint of that particular antenna. Footprint of this particular antenna, and it is generally we are considering it to be in circular in shape, because it radiates equally in all the directions. Hence, we call that as circular footprint. Just the whatever the antenna that I am trying to have it, radiates equally in all the directions. So how far it can transmit or how far it can reach, that is what the important task that we are understanding from this footprint. Footprint is basically the coverage area of this particular antenna. To further understand this concept, let me say I have a mobile here. So distance from the base station is D. Suppose if the transmitter is transmitting with a power PT and PR is the received power at the mobile handset. Mathematical equation that we have is received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. This is in case of free space. Assuming that you do not have anything in between, just the medium, free space I am trying to consider. In such a case, the mathematical expression that we have, it is received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. Means what is that we are understanding from that is received power is going to decrease as the distance increase. That is one concept. And then I have written something called sensitivity here. I hope in communication systems, you might have seen the term sensitivity. How do you define basically a sensitivity? You can say that sensitivity is basically a minimum amount of power required at the input of your receiver, or minimum amount of the signal strength that is required at the input of your receiver so that your receiver can detect the signal. That means I'm trying to transmit this so-and-so transmission power, and this receiver is trying to receive it. Now, when I'm designing this mobile handset, I'll try to put some conditions or some, I have some constraint. That means at least, so much amount of signal strength that should be available at the input of this, so that this will be detecting that particular signal. Beyond that, if the signal strength is good, anyhow, this mobile handset is going to detect. But the weakest signal that it can detect is what we call it as sensitivity. So hence, basically, the received power must be greater than sensitivity of that particular receiver. What is that we are trying to understand from that? Received power is greater than sensitivity. Received power is the amount of power with respect to distance, the amount of power that you are trying to receive here. And sensitivity is the requirement of your mobile handset. That means what minimum that I should have at the input so that I can detect that received power. That is what we call it as sensitivity. So if the received power is greater than sensitivity level, definitely, your mobile handset is going to detect that particular signal, and it can process that particular signal. So you can see that range of, or basically the range of this for which the received signal strength is greater than the sensitivity of this particular, okay, is called, of this mobile handset, is called the footprint of this particular antenna. Okay, so basically the range or the distance over which the received signals, and that means you can move in this particular direction up to any particular distance, but you should not go beyond your sensitivity level. So basically the footprint is range of D for which the received signal strength at the input must be greater than, okay, your sensitivity level. So this is the condition that you have. The received power should be greater than the sensitivity level of this particular receiver, and that is the, and whatever is the area that is what is being covered is what you call it as footprint of that particular antenna. This is what is very important, because we can see that in wireless communication, user is subjected to mobility. So if he keeps on moving in this particular direction on a high speed vehicle, okay, you may lose the signal, because as the distance increases, the received power would be decreasing. Now if it goes beyond your sensitivity level, then you will not be able to detect that particular signal. Okay, that means you are going beyond the footprint of this particular antenna. So hence what you have to do is, probably you may have to tell somebody else to take care of that. So such a kind of scenarios that you have to understand, that just try to understand the concept of footprint. Footprint is basically the, okay, basically this condition, okay, it should be satisfying. The received power should be greater than the sensitivity level of the receiver. Okay, that is the basic definition of your circular footprint. And you can see that so far I have not kept anything. I just kept that the medium is basically a free space. But in more practical case, this need not be the, okay, situation. More practical case, you have a free space. You will not have free space, but you have buildings, man-made structures, okay, or possibly the trees and cars and all those things, you have it. Now you can see that in this particular case, if I have a, okay, building, then the signal has to penetrate through the walls of that particular building. Then obviously when it is getting penetrating through the walls of the building, you can see that there will be some amount of loss. That means it cannot go to the same distance whatever that we are expecting it. Hence the footprint of that particular antenna in free space, I can take it to be circular, because ideal case, assuming that all the directions equal kind of losses that you have. But in more practical cases, in this direction I have more amount of attenuation, I do not have anything in between, here I have more direct, more attenuation. So you will not have this circular shape. Rather than that, what you have it is, you will have some, okay, random shape that you have, some irregular shape that you will be having it. So more practically, the footprint of that would be having some irregular shape. Okay, so that is the concept of the circular, or basically the footprint. Okay, and in this, because our practical case is what we have to consider. Okay, now what all are the cell shapes? Okay, this particular thing, we said it is a cell and I am putting a base station. And this particular cell, what should I consider? Should I consider a circular shape or some other shapes? Okay, for mathematical analysis and all, okay, that we will try to see it now. So the different possibilities that we have, it is probably I can take up a circular shape and I can put up a base station here, another circular shape, I can put up another base station, okay, and so on. But if I'm considering such a kind of cell shapes, the basic problem is, you can see that this particular area is not being covered. That is a basic disadvantage when I'm trying to consider the circular cell shape. The other, to avoid this, you can go for other shape. That means if I'm trying to go for this rectangular shape, cell shape, of course, okay, you will be able to, okay, you can see that the cover is being, this particular area is being covered here. But the problem with this is, if I'm trying to put up a particular base station, if I'm trying to put up a base station over here, you can see that this is not the coverage area of that particular base station. It won't be in rectangular shape. Okay, more or less in ideal case, it would be of circle. So it is not trying to cover the complete area that is covered by this particular base station. So other possible shape that I can consider is more approximated to this year circular, and it should also it should not have this kind of areas. So what I can do is I can consider hexagonal cell shapes. That is the reason why more general we'll try to consider this hexagonal cell shapes. And in this hexagonal cell shapes, you can see that I am trying to put up a base station over here, and it is going to cover this particular area. And more or less, it is a kind of a circle. And more practically, it would be irregular shape, and that irregular shape, okay, more or less would be approximately equal to here. We can approximate it to hexagonal cell shape in all mathematical analysis. And you can see that you do not have such a kind of area in this hexagonal cell shapes. Okay, to have summary on this, say this is the base station that I have. Okay, I can have a circular, or I can have this rectangular, but circular, the basic problem is it should be kind of ideal, but you have such a kind of areas, hence we are trying to avoid. And this rectangular, you can see that this base station is still covering this particular area, but this is saying that okay, it is not covering. So these areas are not being okay utilized properly, hence we will not go for this rectangular. But you can see that this hexagonal cell shape more or less approximately equals your circular shape. And on top of that, you can see that you will have some irregular shape in the coverage area of this because of the man-made structures present in this particular free space. Hence, for all mathematical analysis and all, from now on, we will try to consider this hexagonal cell shapes. Okay. So that is a basic concept that we are trying to consider as far as cell shapes are considered. Now, multiple cell system. So far, what we have considered is a single cell system. In the previous slide, we have considered a single cell system where the basic disadvantage with that is you should have a high antenna height. Antenna height should be very high, and transmission power should be very high, and the bandwidth required would also be very high. To avoid such a kind of things, what we are trying to do is we are trying to divide that geographical area into smaller and smaller regions, and each region we are calling it as a cell, and we are trying to put up such a kind of multiple cells. That means I'm trying to deploy a base station. Okay, these are what the base stations that I'm trying to consider, and what I'm trying to say is, see, I'm trying to divide it into cells, multiple cells, and from now onward, as I said, I'll be considering the hexagonal cell shape. Okay, so this is what we call it as multiple cell system. This is more general, because in general, what will happen? It is more practically, each base station can cover an area of 5 kilometer distance, and then possibly right after that, you will try to deploy another base station, and you'll try to deploy another base station. So this area we call it as cell, and this is another cell, and this is one more cell. So you have multiple cells. That means if this is a geographical area that I'm trying to cover, I'm trying to cover these things with multiple cells or multiple base stations. Now the advantage with this is what? Now you can see that this particular base station, the antenna height of this particular base station need not be very high, because this has to cover only this much distance. So the antenna height of that, you can reduce it, and you can put it to be very low antenna height. That is the first advantage. And the transmission power, because this has to transmit only the users within this particular area, the transmission power would also be very less. And the bandwidth requirement would also be, because he has to cover only these many number of users within this particular area, hence the bandwidth requirement would also be very low. So the advantage with this multiple cell systems is, like, the transmission power is small, and the bandwidth required would also be small, and then the height of antenna also, it can be very small. That is the advantage that we have with this multiple cell systems. Okay, now of course, okay, every advantage comes with some disadvantage also. We will try to come up this particular topic of handoff probably little later, because now as the cell size is decreasing, to get the advantage of these things, you can see that if I have a user who is moving from this cell to another cell, okay, If he is on a high speed train, within no time he will be transmitting from this cell to another cell. Then what we have to do is, the call has to be handed over from this cell to another cell. That particular concept of handing over call from one cell to another cell is what we call it as handoff. Number of handoffs would be increasing. Okay, anyhow, this concept we'll try to see it separately. Let's go through this multiple cell system. Okay, so multiple cell system is basically you have each geographical area, you're trying to divide it into different cells and you're trying to deploy some base stations in it. Okay, and to get the advantage, okay, we will try to look at the concept of frequency reuse. It is very much essential to have the concept of frequency reuse in order to, okay, improve the capacity of the system. Capacity in the sense, the number of users covered. That's a general thing that one can consider. So just look at the concept of frequency reuse. Suppose this is the geographical area that I wanted to cover. Okay, now what I have to do? I have to start deploying my base stations here. That means I can divide each and every this complete area into smaller and smaller cells, and I can deploy multiple cells and I can deploy multiple base stations. That's the basic idea. Okay, so first what I will do, I'll try to put up a base station here. Okay, let's assume that this is a base station cell. Along with that, I have a base station, and then I'll try to take up another cell with another base. Okay, and then you have another, okay, base station that I'm trying to deploy it over here, and then probably another FI 6 and 7. You can see that this complete geographical area I'm trying to cover with these cells with so many number of base stations. Okay, 7 number of base stations that I have it, and then I'm trying to cover this complete area. Okay, so generally, okay, if I'm trying to group these particular cells, then we call this as a cluster. Okay, basically the definition of a cluster is, cluster is group of cells. Okay, this cluster is group of cells. So I can call this as single cluster. Okay, this I can call it as a single cluster where I have 7 cells in that particular cluster. Okay, and try to understand the concept of this, whatever I have mentioned here, F1. Okay, that means what? To see, basically this concept of F1 is the channels that are available in this particular base station. As we said, it is frequency reuse. So we are trying to talk about the frequency channels. So let us assume that F1, let us assume that F1, whatever that we have discussed about the radio spectrum, we said F1 is a channel. And let us assume that I have only a single channel that is available here. And you can see that the same channel is not being allocated here. And here I have different channel, different channels along this. That means I'm not reusing that particular channels anywhere. Okay, hence the frequency, okay, frequency reuse equal to 1. I'm writing it as frequency reuse equal to 1. That means I'm using only one time. Just for understanding sake, okay, for more understanding sake, just in this case, just assume that F1 means 100 channels, 1 to 100. F2 means 200 channels, that means 200 to 300. Again, this also 100 channels. And F3 means 301 to 399. And then F4 means 400 to probably 401 to 499. So on. So how many number of channels that are available if I'm trying to look at in this particular geographical area? F1 means 100 channels. F2 means more 100, 100, 100, 100. So 7. The cluster size is what? Basically 7. So 7 into 100. So the total capacity of this particular system is what? 700. 700 means what? This particular base station can cover 100 number of users in this particular area. And this can cover 100 number of users. This can cover 100 number of users. And so on. Yeah, 700 number of users can be covered in this geographical area. Okay, that is the capacity of the system. Still, we have not reused any frequencies. It is frequency reuse one, means it is as good as no frequency reuse. So remember, the capacity of the system is now 700. That means 700 simultaneous users can be covered in this particular area. Now, moving on, extending the frequency reuse concept. Okay, suppose now what I'm doing it is I am trying to keep the area same, the previous geographical area, whatever that I have, I'm trying to keep the same geographical area. But this time what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to reduce the cell size. Okay, and then I'm trying to deploy that particular base station. So I'm trying to club these three, okay, these three cells, and these three cells put together, I will call it as a cluster. Okay, and what I'm trying to do it here, it is now you can see again, the number of frequencies in F1 is 100, 100, 100. So total number of users that can be covered is 300 here, F1, F2 and F3. And now what I'm trying to do it is because, okay, I'm trying to reduce the cell size, multiple cell system, reducing the cell size. So the transmission power, okay, required would also be very less. So now what I'm trying to do it is I have some set of frequencies here, a same set of frequencies, I'm trying to reuse it. Okay. Again, I'm defining cluster size to be three because three is the number of cells that I have. These three, I'm trying to group it. You can see that the same set, I'm trying to repeat it in this geographical location. And this area and this area are different. And you can see that I'm trying to put it in such a way that I have some distance between the same kind of channel that are being allocated. Okay. So that way, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to keep on reuse the same set of frequencies in this location or probably in this location here. And then this location, another location. Okay, so now you can see that I'm able to cover this complete geographical area. Now what, now you see the, try to see the capacity of the system. You can see that this particular cluster alone can cover 300 number of users. Such a kind of clusters, how many you have? Okay, you can keep on counting that you have, you are trying to reuse it seven number of times. That means this is one, two, just you can count F1. F1, I'm using here 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. That means same set of frequencies, I'm trying to reuse it at a, okay, location nearby, so that, okay, the number of users covered would also be increasing for us. So this way, what will happen it is, now if I'm trying to calculate the capacity of the system, each cluster can accommodate 300 number of users and it is getting repeated seven times. So 300 into 7, 2100 users are being covered. Now you see the geographical area is same in the as that of the previous case, but now the number of, okay, the users that you are trying to cover is getting increased because of the concept of frequency reuse. Same thing, I'm trying to extend it. Okay, for, see, again, cluster size of 7. Let's see. Say this is the geographical area. In all these cases, let us assume that the geographical area that has to be covered is same. Now I'm trying to put up, see, F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6, and F7. Now, what is the cluster size here? 7. Cluster size of 7. And, okay, I'm trying to repeat same here, repeating here, as well as here, here. Okay, and you can see in all these cases, I do not have that, okay, and I'm, you have, there is no path or there is no area that is not being covered. There is a reason why you do consider these hexagonal cell shapes. And you can see that, you can, we can see that, okay, how many number of times that I have reused that? Okay, 7. Now, if I'm trying to calculate what is the capacity of the system, each cluster size is 7. So 700 multiplied by 7 times. That means somewhere around 4,900 or nearly 5,000 number of users you are trying to cover. So that is the advantage of the concept of frequency reuse. Okay, and again you can see that if I'm trying to take up F1, you try to increase the cluster size, as you try to keep on increasing the cluster size, the distance between these cells are getting increased. That means what? The interference, because these two are same, so that means the interference portion is getting reduced. Whereas in case of previous case, a cluster size equal to 3, more or less there were somewhat closer. In that case, the interference was quite higher when compared with this. But we can assume that this is, as the cluster size is increasing, then the interference would also be decreasing. So this is the advantage of the frequency reuse. When I'm trying to use it 7 times, you can see that, and you can see that frequency reuse 1, we were able to cover 700, and then frequency reuse 2, we are able to cover 2100, and frequency 3 and frequency reuse 7, basically it is around 4900, is being the covered or the capacity of the system. So you have significant amount of improvement in the capacity with the concept of frequency reuse. But of course, now all these things should be done in a very graceful manner, this frequency allotments, otherwise there will be a problem. Just let's look at that particular problem. Say if this is the cluster size 7, so I have allotted F1, I have started F1 here, and then F2, F3, F4, F5, F6 and F7. And here also I am doing in the same way, F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6, F7. I am not changing the order, whatever that I have followed here, I am trying to order so that these two will be kept, these two will be kept away, so that the interference would be less. The same color means same set of frequencies. Or probably in other location also, I'm trying to do F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6 and F7. Okay. Again, F2, you can see that there is a distance. Okay. But if somebody is not doing in this graceful manner, then there will be a problem. For example, this also, probably the same way that I followed. But this, see, F1 is this, I'm supposed to start F2 here. Okay, but what I've done is I've started here F2. So F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6 and F7. Now you can see that these two are having same set of frequencies. Hence, you will get some interference here. That's the disadvantage, that you have if you are not doing in a proper manner. The allotment of these channels, if you are not doing in a proper manner, then you will get this particular interference. Okay, that means these things has to be done. Like, I've not done these things to show that complete picture. I've kept it as it is. So the basic problem here is this one, interference. These two are getting interfered. Okay, so that's the problem with this frequency reuse if you are not doing it properly. Okay, so ultimately with the concept of this particular frequency reuse, what the advantage that we are trying to get it is, you are trying to cover more and more number of users. There are other methods, with which you can improve the capacity of that particular system, like frequency splitting and frequency sectorization, or cell splitting and cell sectorization. Those concepts we'll try to see it in the next class. Just for a while, I'll try to stop presenting it, and then I'll try to take up the questions.